Good afternoon, everybody. I would like to thank UNICEF and DEF for giving me this opportunity to present our community monitoring project called Arogya Shreni, which was carried out in Mysore district for a period of about 3 years. I'll very briefly talk about our organization. GRAM is essentially a public policy research organization. Yeah, and what we are trying to do uniquely in terms of research is try to have community perspective in all our researches. And also, you know, our experience had been that a lot of research just gets limited in academic circles, and this needs to be converted and taken for advocacy on public policy. So we also work, our underlying principle is that development itself has to be an expansion of human capabilities. We go with that definition of development, and for which the, you know, all stakeholders are important. So our brand of advocacy necessarily is also, you know, collaborative and not confrontational. So we were formally founded in January 2011. We have done different kinds of projects, evaluations, research and analysis, and you know, community engagement, consultancies, and we've had the opportunity to work in multiple sectors. And public health is one sector which seems to dominate our work also. And the presentation which I'm going to a project which I'm going to talk about is of the public health domain itself. So Arogya Shreni, the name, you know, kind of Arogya is health and Shreni is ranking, essentially was a project to rank the primary health centers in Mysore district and use the community's inputs to rank them. As I had mentioned in the comment earlier, the National Rural Health Mission, you know, mandates various committees at you know, at the village level, at the PHC level, at the sub-center level, and so on. So, and we, you know, kind of took upon ourselves this project of, you know, empowering the communities to monitor. We had some ideas of, you know, there are very subtle differences between what community participation means, what community monitoring means. You know, NRHM also says that community should handle funds, which is essentially a governance issue. So our community is really able to do that. And in this project, we did, for the community inputs, we had the intervention of mobile technology. So essentially, you know, kind of we were seeking some answers. One, you know, do communities have the capacity to monitor something as which is perceived as technical as health, you know, and can rural communities use technology for monitoring, and whether, you know, this community participation in monitoring, can it even lead to any changes or improvements in PHCs? There were, you know, kind of different stages in the project. We can broadly divide it into 5 blocks. You know, first, you know, kind of the internal preparation for the project, the development of tools, questionnaire, software, and so on. And at the same time, we had to go out there in the community. You know, we had a trained field team who would interact with the community. The monitoring and the planning and monitoring committee at the PHC level was the committee which were the respondents for this project. Many times it so happens that many committees are on paper, they're not really activated. So at quite a few places we had this task of even activating those committees. And then, you know, then you had to train them on monitoring. So for this we had developed questionnaires, we got in a lot of stakeholders together, PHC doctors, you know, some public health specialists, the you know, ASHA workers together, and prepared a set of questionnaires. And these were, you know, kind of, we also had a pen and paper survey, and then there was tool developed where, you know, kind of the and the community could answer those on IVR. And internally, we use this for ranking the primary health centers, which was one of our main goals. But then we also realized that, you know, just ranking the primary health centers, there are 112 rural PHCs in Mysore. Just ranking them 1 to 112 doesn't really serve anything. We categorize those rankings into RCH services, into infrastructure, into other services, say, such as availability of medicines. So what happened as a result of that, is that the health department at the district level could even see, okay, which PHCs are performing poorly or which taluk PHCs are performing poorly in infrastructure or who is offering better delivery or maternity services. So we were able to, you know, get a very comprehensive database of what are the facilities of PHCs at various levels. And then this ranking was also disseminated to not just the participants of the project, but to the doctors, to the taluk health officers, the district health officers, even the elected representatives. Even the local MLA was very keen on, you know, kind of seeing these ranking cards. And then, you know, the project organically went a step ahead, you know, where, you know, we were also facilitating advocacy for change. Why I say this, that it organically went ahead, is because advocacy for change wasn't so much in the plans, in the initial plans of the project. What happened was when community was answering these questions, and, you know, they were writing no for, okay, do you have anti-rabies vaccine? No. I mean, you do that month after month, then, you know, you get a little restless. Okay, now what do I do about changing this, you know? And it was, you know, it was a community's idea that, okay, let's mobilize people together and let's do something about it. I'll talk a little more about that in the further slides. And this is what that small arrow indicates. You know, although maybe the plan A was to finish with dissemination, and, you know, we were inspired by the community to go ahead and facilitate advocacy process. And the central block is where the use of mobile technology came into picture. So we had pre-registration of phone numbers to accept survey responses, and then the community was calling on a toll-free number. Then we had used a software called Asterisk, which converts any basic computer to a voice communication server, where we stored the data and we were able to retrieve it through the web interface. And then, you know, ranking of PHCs based on, you know, weighted averages. We had evolved through this project. When we started off with the project, we, you know, kind of had equal weights for all sorts of questions. And then we thought, okay, some questions are more important than the other, which indicate the quality of service. So eventually we moved on to weighted averages. And then we used SMS blast to disseminate the ranking information. So when we began, we started with 79 questions, and then, which was, you know, in a subsequent phase of the project, we reduced it to 36 questions. They needed binary inputs, you know, press 1 for yes, press 0 for no. And in a subsequent phase, we even had numerical inputs. Okay, what is the OPD rate of your PHC? Yeah, and then, you know, communities were answering those with numbers. So I've already said that, you know, there are 139 PHCs in Mysore. We left out the urban PHCs. So 112 rural PHCs in Mysore, and these were different categories, you know, taluk ranks, district ranks, and ranks based on the kind of services. So, there was a small audio clip which was supposed to play here, but I can play that in the lunchtime. So it asks a question, you know, something like, you know, does your doctor come to the PHC every day? And, you know, you answer yes or no. And we retrieve the information in this format, and then then we apply a ranking methodology, and this is a kind of ranking card which is generated out of it. A ranking, you know, I have some samples of the ranking card sets. So with every ranking cycle, we generate 8 cards, one for each taluk. There are 7 taluks in Mysore and a district ranking card. And this is, you know, sent across to the officials, to the elected representatives, everybody. And to the participants, we also send out an SMS about the ranking of their own PHC. Say, for example, this, you know, talks about the PHC in HD Kote Taluk and what is its district rank and what is its taluk rank. So that keeps the excitement on, and then the community is able to see something which they have given inputs for, and they see some sort of an output out of it. So you know, considering the context of today's event, I think some of these observations would be useful for discussion. What this project has shown us is that rural communities have been able to use technology for monitoring. I call it moderately complex because we added the numerical inputs at a, you know, later stage in the project, and we were being able to use that. We had, you know, our parent organization had done, you know, community empowerment exercise for, you know, decades in SDMCs, in village health and sanitation committees, in water and sanitation, various places. What we could see different in this activity was that using the mobile itself, there was some sort of a novelty aspect which kindled their interest. You know, so we haven't captured numerical data about it, but we do have this very strong sense that, you know, technology was able to draw community towards this. And then there is a positive perception about community when we use technology for data collection. They believe that it's not going to be manipulated. They believe that it's going to reach some government office somewhere, which they don't see in the case of a pen and paper survey. Okay. Now, and we were initially worried that, okay, would they be able to press 0? Would they be able to press 1 for the right answer? We did involve some sort of a correction mechanism in all that, but we also had our own validation checks, and even when the questionnaire was 79 questions long, the error margin compared to the, you know, pen and paper survey and what we received on the mobile as inputs was less than 2%, which was a very encouraging sign for us. I mean, that also, you know, again goes to show that rural communities are able to use technology. It definitely, you know, kind of lowered the time and manpower required for, you know, subsequent ranking cycles. Each ranking cycle, the time that you took to, you know, collect your people, ask them to answer, okay, between this date and this date you have to answer questions. I mean, all that process kept on becoming faster. And, you know, there was enthusiasm about the project. And after every quarter, you know, if Gram was to visit the district health office for something, maybe nothing related to Arogya Shreni, I mean, the DHO or the DHO secretary would ask, okay, have you sent the latest ranking card? You know, the DHO was asking for this, or it was raised in some meeting. So we were, you know, quite happy about that kind of enthusiasm. And yeah, now the NRHM says that, you know, community should you know, monitor. What we realized, you know, kind of much later in this project is the use of technology here is laying down the structure of how you should monitor. So it mirrors the work that they are supposed to do, and I think that's a key you know, point to make monitoring successful or any sort of participation. If your process which uses technology is as similar to the roles which are, you know, kind of mentioned in maybe a document, you try to do something which they are supposed to do. You know, I think that's one key of making things work. So, you know, yeah, so it works in Mysore. We had our fair share of challenges as well. I'll talk about it in a bit. But apart from monitoring, we had also a third question. Can this participation in monitoring lead to change? And that's where, you know, kind of, that's what makes us happy about this project. You know, participation in monitoring, you know, has motivated communities to, you know, kind of advocate for change. One thing which we observed is, you know, there is better awareness. It also leads to a better articulation of changes. If some MLA had visited some village and asked about the PHC, they would say either give a very sweeping statement, it is useless, it doesn't work, doctor doesn't come on, you know, come at all, or there's nothing here, which are very absolute sweeping statements. To now the same community could answer, okay, what, how is your PHC functioning? Then they would say, okay, there is no blood pressure apparatus. So, you know, it's a normal tendency to highlight your problems when a district official or an MLA visits your area, but when you are able to give your grievance in a very specific manner, that also helps that official address it in a better way. So we've seen this articulation of issues change. The doctors and the community, there is always a power distance, you know, especially in India, between the doctor and the patients or the community. We have seen that this power distance has reduced by regular engagement, you know, with the doctor, having regular meetings, and the doctor also, you know, feels that, okay, he's part of the community. He puts his own suggestions of what can, you know, kind of change. And over a period of time, there have been some, you know, kind of very well documented changes which the communities have been able to drive. Now we know for a fact that in India and even in Karnataka, you know, the health department runs short of staff. Rural doctors are a problem. Despite this, you know, the community has been able to get 6 doctors, you know, installed in PHCs where there were no doctors or no regular doctors, you know, using their own, you know, circles of influence. The community is very innovative. When they sit together, they say, okay, I know, you know, maybe I can write a letter to the Zilla Panchayat. Okay, I know this Taluk Health Officer, and they can make some sort of an arrangement. And they are very innovative. So what we did was, you know, facilitate that forum, you know, just create that forum for dialogue. And then we believe things can, you know, community can find a lot of local solutions. So a lot of the issues addressed were about infrastructure. They've been able to get some funds other than the regular PHC funds to construct labs. And there are changes which, you know, kind of go beyond the PHC also. Now, we've had examples of, you know, the community members saying that there's a place called Sargur, which also has a private hospital, and the PHC. By themselves, they said, okay, our PHC seems to have all the facilities. Let's make people use the government service rather than, you know, go to a private hospital. There was a PHC where the family planning operations had stopped because of some problem earlier, and the doctors were very hesitant to restart. The Panchayat Raj members gave an assurance, okay, we'll ensure all sorts of protection. You go ahead with the camp, you know, kind of the awareness for this, and getting people, you know, convinced. You know, we and the ASHA workers and the A&M together, we'll do that. And what you see there is an auto. This is in a village called Hura, which is fairly remote, and there's no emergency transport facility available. even if they have to call the nearest 108 ambulance, it would take a minimum of 45 minutes to get there. So in one of the discussions, they found out people who are willing to say that, okay, I'll use my auto, you know, service as a, you know, as an emergency vehicle. I mean, these are lots of discussions can lead to very simple and innovative solutions. In fact, what's written on the auto is Herigege Uchita. It's like, it's free in case if it is being used for a maternity service. I mean, that was a innovative young fellow there. So, yeah, like I said, we had our challenges also. One of the challenges was that in rural areas, the mobile numbers keep changing very frequently. You know, because there's some service operator who comes, okay, you pay 20 rupees, you get a, you know, SIM card, and that was quite challenging. There have also been, you know, kind of villages where the going is not that easy. There are some elites in the village who would capture the bulk of the dialogue, and you know, it can be very draining to the field facilitator in such times. But we still have to look ahead, and we have to look at, you know, the sustainability of this model. You know, a research organization, you know, trying to work on, say, community issues cannot forever hold the technology back end. That has to be taken, you know, owned by something which is more stable, like the state. Mysore has its own set of socioeconomic characteristics, so we have to pilot it in other districts. Maybe if it was to be done in a district in North Karnataka where the socioeconomic health indicators are much poorer than Mysore, then the kind of gestation period for it to be successful would be different. So it's definitely useful to try it in a few more districts. But we now have an idea of, you know, kind of what would work and what wouldn't work. We are trying to make sure that, you know, all the information is available. There is like a manual available which talks about, you know, how do you answer for what kind of question, and how do you advocate for different kind of issues. Then we also, you know, kind of came out with a compilation of the narratives of the field facilitators. You know, these are very rich, you know, about the day-to-day challenges they face. And one observation over a period of time we have is, if community monitoring can work in something like health, it can definitely work in other sectors like PDS and education, which these are sectors which people in general relate much better to. And we had this small discussion about the participation of women. Now these 5 respondents per PHC, which also has women in them, suddenly there is something which makes them feel equal. You know, now the 5 members from the committee which are chosen as respondents, there could be a Dalit woman, there could be a Gram Panchayat vice president, there could be, you know, somebody who's traditionally known to capture voice in a discussion, but answering the questionnaire makes them, you know, kind of feel equal. Though we haven't scientifically captured that, I think in a very subtle way it does bring some sort of an empowerment. And I was having this chat with a friend here, and what we saw in the project also, in the second half of the project, the women respondents started using their own phones, while in the first half of the project they used the mobile phones of their husbands. And I would like very much agree with the gentleman who had said in the morning that even in Karnataka, or at least in Mysore, it is people who own phones and not households. So that's the difference we have from, you know, say northern India, so which is true in Mysore also. Now I wouldn't say that Arogya Shreni made them buy their own phone. There would be a lot of other environment factors, but maybe, you know, there are these kind of subtle things, qualitative things, which you know, have led to these changes. there are, you know, it also has broken down barriers among stakeholders. You know, I mean, this is something we have to look at largely, I feel. A minister or an IAS officer is, you know, sitting maybe in his, you know, building in his ivory tower, but you know, the mobile phone can break through all security and protocol. So, and this has happened, you know. So, the doctors, the PhD doctors, are supposed to disclose their mobile numbers to the community, and no matter you know how many compounders he puts around you, you can break the barrier through the mobile phone and reach the stakeholder. The same holds good for a Zilla Panchayat office or for a minister or a secretary. I mean, it holds good for an advocacy organization like us as well. You know, if we have to reach the minister directly or something like that. So, mobile phone as a barrier breaker, I think, should be studied and explored further. So, and yeah, I kind of end with the comment with which we started the day. You know, kind of, it's a mobiles. Penetration is so high, you know, kind of, it has to be, you know, kind of, we'd rather use it for, you know, development than, you know, kind of ignore it. I mean, and it's something which we use daily. I will leave with one quote by Ralph Nader, who says there can be no daily democracy without daily citizenship. So let's use mobiles for our daily citizenship. Thank you.
Changes that have been brought in the status of health due to your monitoring?
Our project ended this March. We ourselves plan to go back to the community at various points, maybe after 6 months, to see if the committees are still working. But if your question relates to health indicators of a district or a taluk, no, there's no study done. Not that I am aware of.
Because the system may be in place, you may divulge the numbers of the PHC members and the minister's number, but still they may call, but the cell phone may be switched off. The PHC nurse, she may switch off the cell phone. That's a system that we see.
Right.
So how do we monitor that? That is another problem that we have.
I do not have a direct answer to this, but you know, mobile phones also let us know very easily how many times it has been called and how many times it has been switched off. So we can have data of how many times the minister was not reachable. I don't know if that I know it doesn't answer your question per se. Of course, there is a huge attitudinal aspect in that. You know, kind of, even with mobile or anything, if somebody wants to be cut off from the world, he can. You know, so there is an attitudinal aspect in that. But I would also look at it in a slightly positive sense. This is something we've been experiencing as an organization. Kind of, when we take our data to the government, they know that it's reliable data. It is something which they can, use in their work. They also want to look at something reliable, which helps them do their work better. And if communities can establish that, say even if we take the example of a PhD, if the communities can establish the fact that okay, whatever data they give about their village, about their PhD. A taluk health officer would be interested in getting reliable data. So that's something that's possible. But as a study on the impact per se, there's nothing I'm aware of. Yeah.
Can you share any of the political repercussions that happen? Because when there is a monitoring happening, I'm very sure there is always a opposite current that is flowing, and is there any interesting repercussions, political repercussions that happened due to this monitoring, where the people ask a lot of questions on the when there is data, alerting data, alarming data coming up?
Yes and no. Political repercussions in the sense we did have the share of doctors who were maybe not so cooperative in the project, who wouldn't want their say PHC data to be revealed. But these were a very kind of small number, and this is the reason why I insist that these have to be tried in other districts where the agency which is maybe doing the survey doesn't have a brand name already. The weight of our parent organization has also, because SVYM has worked in public health for the last 30 years, the health department, all the PHC doctors, the taluk health mechanism knows SVYM and usually would end up cooperating with the because there has been a tradition of working with the health department for quite some time, but it could be different in a different district. So that definitely is a factor. We've also had our cases of say committees which would just go on talking about the problem with no solutions, and where the discussion is just a just an ego discussion at the end of it. I mean, those experiences are also there, and they, some of them are captured in this, where see, field workers also sometimes they put a very small effort and some big change happens, and then sometimes they put hours of effort, days of effort, getting five people together, and still it doesn't, things don't move. I mean, there have been those cases, but to broadly answer the question of political repercussions, what we have observed is that any committee which is, so many committees which are subcommittees of the Gram Panchayat, who are supposed to do participation, monitoring, governance, all those things. To an extent, in any committee discussion, there is some amount of elite capture. So, for example, if the committee has to decide about how 75,000 rupees on a PHC has to be sent, there will be a bunch of elite within that committee who will, dominate that discussion. And, so absolute breaking down of that elite and an absolute democratic discussion is something very difficult to see. We have to take that into account, and at least those are some of the perils of decentralization also. But the fact that decentralization has allowed that discussion to happen in a village committee rather than an office in Bangalore itself is a positive step, and I think we have to see that elite. That elite capture will happen.
Any other questions? I have a question. What was your challenge in promoting the survey? I mean, when you started out, what was the biggest challenge in getting people to participate?
See, one is, a slightly roundabout answer. There is, when it comes to a rural citizen, we expect a very high level of citizenship among them, to be part of this committee, to monitor this, to monitor that. Whereas I am, an urban citizen, I don't even know when the Lok Adalats happen, but I do get power and road and, everything. But, a rural citizen has to, fight for that, fight for practically everything. So that's that is a challenge, that you need something as basic as health, but and so you can get that if you activate this committee. Getting over that is
the biggest.
Is a difficult part, but again, like I said, since our parent organization's work was there with the community, so some sort of rapport, especially in the taluks which we had worked, we have worked intensively in at least 3 out of the 7 taluks, so that kind of eased in our case. And when we started off with the village health and sanitation committee, and though they are stakeholders in the improvement of a PHC, we realized that okay, they are not as direct a stakeholder as the PHC planning and monitoring committee, so we had to shift that. And VHSCs, they are under a lot of spotlight, so there have been state level programs for activation of VHCs but not for the PMCs, so a lot of PMCs had to be started from scratch. So that was one of the challenges.
Thank you.